Welcome. We have family who have traveled from New York, North Pole, Alaska, Missouri, Texas, and friends who have traveled from out of state as well. We are grateful and honored by your presence with us and appreciate very much your love and prayers as we celebrate a few remembrances of Mom's life today and the Savior whom she loved and served. Please bow with me in prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you through your Holy Spirit for helping Mom come to know you and proclaim you. Please help us to honor you in this service as we honor the life you lived through Mom, and help us to stimulate each other to love and good deeds. In Jesus' name, amen.
We'd like to start by singing. Would you join us in singing, "Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing"? The words will be on the screen for you.
We once did a 15-minute skit from Porgy and Bess about a couple who were experts at fighting. Toward the end, she sang, "Selfish as a man can be." And I sang, "No matter what you say, ah, still suits me." And then she'd hit me over the head real hard with a plastic dish pan, and everyone would laugh. Mom was passionate about the truth. She wrote bold letters in opposition to distortion of truth that were published in the Register Guard. She also wrote high school drama teachers about the importance of maintaining integrity and truth in the plays. In 1975, we started working with the wonderful International Student Foundation at the University of Oregon. This connected the students with local people. you'd correspond with them. They didn't have email. Then you'd meet them at the airplane and take them home with you and introduce them to I have to read it because I can wander to don't get done in time. Anyhow, you took them to your home and introduced them to your family, community, stores, banks, and helped them through registration. It took about 4 days and they got to bond well with you and your family. It was a wonderful introduction to their new life, and it grew into birthday celebrations, holiday celebrations, and they were able to learn and observe how we as Christian Americans used our freedoms. They heard the presidential proclamations about Thanksgiving and our history. They could ask any questions they wanted. It was always a meaningful and significant time. If they moved onto the campus, they often came for dinner in the evening twice a month. Virginia did this for over 50 students over the years and all our children, and I supported her. It's good for us. As life had to slow down the last year or two on Fox Hollow, one of us would say, "I'm too tired to have someone over," or "the house is too much of a mess." But we kept having students in on weekends and others on Sunday. Although we were not always in agreement on having guests, when they left and we were cleaning up a little, there was never one time that we are not happy with a good time we had had. And we knew God had been there too, and He was happy about what we had done. That included what He had done too. Oh, I gotta throw this in. My dad always said when he's complimented extravagantly, "Oh, it's all God's fault." The last month of her life, she thanked me every day for taking such good care of her. At least 3 times she said, "Bob, you always have taken good care of me." And I got to say, "I have always loved you." It is a happy, happy privilege. We had a great life, and we want to help you have one too. And so I want to give you a blessing, and it's the same one that Paul gave at the end of his letter to the 2 Corinthians. And it goes like, it's the Peterson translation, the Message. "The amazing grace of our Master Jesus Christ, the extravagant love of God, the intimate fellowship with the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen."
This photo was taken on Thanksgiving Day, just 6 weeks before Mom's death. At that time, I did not expect Mom to be gone so soon. There were about 40 of us, and after our feasting and fellowship around the tables, we all took turns sharing something for which we were grateful. When it was Mom's turn, she retold a story which she had told many times before. She said she was thankful for the mumps. She said when she was about 22, almost 70 years ago, she was studying at the University of Oregon when she got the mumps. The university quarantined her, placing her in isolation around the Thanksgiving holiday for around 2 weeks. She had met Bob Pearson in the First Baptist Church college group. He heard about her misfortune, and he took her his favorite treat, an ice cream cone.
Because he was not allowed into her room, he stood at her door and gave the ice cream cone to a nurse who delivered it to Virginia in her bed. Then he sat on a chair in the doorway, peeled an apple, cut it into slices, and tossed it. Tossed the slices to her, and she delightedly caught them in her bed with a shriek of joy, and she savored every morsel as they laughed and told stories. She insisted that there was nothing going on between them. Bob was just a thoughtful guy who would do that for anyone who was lonely and having a tough time. In about 2 more years, they married at First Baptist Church. This was just one of many stories that she loved to share with us about her life. After that day, Mom would go to the Crescent Park restaurant for meals with Dad and the rest of us, but she didn't eat much or drink much. Then she didn't even leave her room to eat, saying she didn't feel like going. But when food was brought to her, she ate very little. I could tell that she was dying. So I notified the family and told them that if they wanted to see and spend time with Mom before she died, they should come now. And they did. She greeted us with joy and always asked how we were doing and what we were concerned about. While she had senior dementia with short-term memory loss, her long-term memory was very sharp all the way to the end of her life. And she recognized our voices on the phone and always asked how we were doing and wanted to know all of our most recent challenges, achievements, concerns, and thoughts. Donna, my wife, sat by my side as I sat beside Mom, as she rested on her right side on the edge of her bed on Mom's last afternoon and evening on earth. I put my fingers of my right hand between the fingers and thumb of her left hand. She gripped my hand and held it for hours, moving it back and forth as her breathing slowed and her body temperature declined. During that time, I prayed and asked God for help to comfort and encourage my mother through her pain. Mom couldn't talk, but her eyes would flutter, and she could still move and smile. The Lord directed me to spend the afternoon and evening singing her favorite hymns, choruses, and other songs, quoting comforting scripture passages and expressing my love and gratitude for all that she had done for me and my family for more than 67 years. My brother and sister joined me in some of the singing. Then they joined Dad for supper, the hospice caregiver staying in the kitchen area, as I continued to sing and hum until after the family returned from dinner. We visited, and then we all left to let Dad and Mom sleep. The following morning, Dad had his last morning devotional time with Mom, and then at 8:24, Mom graduated to heaven to be with Jesus for the rest of eternity. Dad called me, and then I informed the rest of our family and some friends. This past Monday, just 5 days ago, Dad, my local siblings, and I transported Mom's body in a casket to be buried near the top of Mount Scott in the Willamette National Cemetery on the east side of Portland. It was covered by a thick blanket of snow. It was beautiful, quiet, reverent, and peaceful, with no one else around. We sang, "I'll Fly Away," as Mom's casket was lowered into the grave. We knew that her soul and spirit were already in heaven, singing grateful praises to her Savior as she saw him face to face and walked with him.
The day Mom left us for her heavenly home was Dad and my anniversary. And again, it just seemed like God was blessing us with the snow. We had had freshly fallen snow, and it was so beautiful and comforting, and it seemed like such a special and fitting reminder of Mom, because on that day, 37 years ago, Mom sang at our wedding, and it was her inspiration for the beautiful setting of the flocked Christmas trees. She had seen them while attending a Christmas program, and when she inquired about them, we were able to haul them off and use them for free. I thank God for the undeniable imprint Mom has had and the many ways she nurtured and prepared me to step into God's call on my life. I was given the same middle name as Mom. I learned that Dale means courageous, and I saw how fitting it had been for each of us. We both were willing, out of our love and desire to obey the Lord, to step out into a great unknown. For Mom, the most obvious thing was that at age 28, she left with two kids to follow her husband's call to Africa. And for me, I followed my husband's call to the prisoners and stepped into jails and prisons here and overseas. Without a doubt, her big heart to touch others with the Lord's love and caring prepared me to have a heart to reach out to the prisoners. When I was 12, Mom and Dad gave me a book on Russia from the Life Book series. Mom wrote a special note in it about my desire and prayers for Khrushchev and the Russians to know the Lord. How amazing it is to realize that I had a heart for Russia long ago. And again, she was aware and encouraged that, and later opened the door where I got to go. God opened the door where I got to go and share the Lord with them myself. Mom led the junior choir, and we kids were in that together. John was the soloist. Never did I want to be. But lo and behold, later on, the Lord led me to sing a song in Russian to the prisoners in the former Soviet Union, sometimes to as many as 400 men, and I got to see God touch their hearts with it. I'm thankful that Mom encouraged me to take piano lessons, and after struggling to continue, she found a new teacher for me who taught me how to play by chords. That opened up a whole new world for me, and interestingly enough, my first ministry involvement at the Lane County Jail was playing the piano for the inmate choir for the Christmas program. Later, Mom gave me the piano, and it helped me in preparing for the Sunday services at the jail for the songs that I would lead the worship in. Mom has been like my best friend. I could talk to her about anything I wanted, and she was a good listener, counselor, and very insightful and witty. And when we were away at boarding school, she always had a letter to send us when the Missionary Aviation Fellowship came to their mission station, which was once or twice a week. I so appreciated her love and caring, her prayers and encouragement, and her desire to do whatever she could to help me. Even at the last, when I greeted Mom, she was sensitive to me, and she asked me, "What was wrong? What can I do to help?" I said, "It's difficult to think of not getting to continue to see you." To my surprise, Mom responded cheerily and definitely. You'll be surprised. You'll do just fine. God cares for you so much. A bushel and a peck. And don't you forget it, she said with a smile. Mom was off the scale in hospitality. I know of no one who had more people over each week for a meal than she and Dad. She was always inviting us over for a meal and automatically did so to the end, forgetting that she no longer was up to going down for a meal. When Mom and Dad moved a year ago into Crescent Park Senior Living, I emptied the kitchen cabinets of all Mom's well-used muffin tins, bread pans, angel food cake pans, salad bowls, waffle irons, etc. It was quite a spread, and all of a sudden it hit me really hard, remembering all the meals and knowing she would not be using them again. Thanksgiving has always been a time of including others as well. Maybe part of that goes back to her grandpa Cyrus owning farmland with water running through it, and his always letting the Indian tribe camp on his property when they pass through each year. In the last years of Mom's life, when she struggled with short-term memory, the gift was that Mom became more free in her spirit and more childlike. Dad had been the hugger, and now when she hugged me, I really felt it. And it was fun to pop in at Crescent Park when Stu was playing the piano. He made you want to dance, and Mom danced with glee and just beamed when she would dance with Dad. Now I envision her praising God with her beautiful voice and smiling face, delighting in her surroundings in heaven. I have no doubt that she has entered into the joy of her Lord and will hear the Lord say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." I know I will continue to thank God for her over and over and look forward to seeing her again.
Of Mom's five kids, it is a known fact that I was Mom's favorite. That is the opinion of all the kids, except four. My mom was a bigger-than-life, multifaceted person, and I'm going to read quickly, because there's a lot to say. On her 43rd birthday, she learned to water ski on the Kwilu River in Bandundu, Africa, a river with hippopotamus and occasional snakes. At age 57, I have a photo of Mom and Dad riding dirt bikes in California. Around 72 years of age, she and Dad flew to Nicaragua to minister to soldiers on very remote jungle army bases. Mom was on a team that flew on Nicaraguan military planes, did the gospel drama for the soldiers, and then got out quickly before opposition guerrilla militants came to harass or attack. At 75, she led the Vacation Bible School at her church due to her strong desire to see youth learn God's word. Around 80, she and Dad went with a group to Cuba to encourage underground Cuban pastors. All her life, she loved to watch ballroom dancing. At 85, she and Dad enrolled in a ballroom dance class, and she would light up like a light bulb when Dad would practice with her at the house. She loved good movies like Fiddler on the Roof, Sound of Music, Sergeant York, Gifted Hands, Seven Brides for Seven Brothers. She also loved hiking, going on walks, camping, going on trips to Crater Lake, Grand Canyon, having grandkids over to teach America's rich faith heritage, and other topics. At 88 years old, she was still conducting a monthly chapel service for homeless women at the Eugene Mission, giving them hope, inspiration, explaining God's love for them, how God had provided salvation on their behalf if they chose to receive the free gift of eternal life through Christ. Her grandchildren hold her in extreme high regard. To be here today, one flew 6,000 miles round trip. Two of them flew 4,000 miles round trip. One flew down from Alaska with his entire family. They wanted to be here to honor her. Politically, she was very involved and engaged. She was not afraid to take strong stands, not afraid of controversy. Personally, when I look at the five most rewarding activities I've been privileged to participate in my life, they can each be traced to seeds planted by Mom through books she read to us as kids, or by comments she made, or by behavior she modeled and exhibited. Up to age 91, when I went to Crescent Park to eat with Mom and Dad, she would often be outside in the parking lot waiting for me to pull in. When I left, she would often be outside waving until my truck disappeared out of sight around the corner. She was a major encourager, supporter, and cheerleader. She believed in me. I could call her or go see her day or night, never ever wondering about how I would be received. Unquestioningly welcomed, wanted, desired, loved, accepted, she could speak courage, belief, confidence, hope, and faith into my life. When I was fearful, doubtful, overwhelmed, she would point me to the Lord, saying that with Jesus it would be no problem. She would say, fear is unnecessary, as all you have to do is choose to trust the Lord. It is just a choice, nothing complicated or advanced, just a choice to trust God. For probably 45 years, Mom and Dad acted as a host family for foreign students at the U of O. Here are comments from two of them from China when I told them Mom and Dad had sold their home and moved to the retirement community. One said, 8 years ago, he emailed me. Mom and Dad greeted me at the Eugene Airport. They were 83 when they picked me up at the airport. They took me to the Golden Orient restaurant for my first meal in Eugene and drove me to the campus to get my student ID. Throughout the 6 years in Eugene, I was welcomed to the most wonderful host family. I was invited to so many family events, even to a wedding, not to mention the concerts. Mom's brownies, baked chicken, salad, Dad's stories, teachings, blessings. The house has given me so many warm memories that I will cherish forever. I'm not so good using English as using Chinese. I wish I could express my feelings better. I am proud and extremely grateful to have Mom and Dad as my family in the States. And I can't say enough about the generosity of Mom and Dad towards me and many other foreign students. Mom and Dad have blessings from all of us. Another Chinese student emailed me when I told her they had moved. She said, I have had lots of warm memories in that house, family dinners, video watching, inspiring talks from Dad. It is a house filled with love. One Chinese student I emailed when Mom passed away, he said, I'm sure Mom is enjoying living with Jesus now. She was such a wonderful person to me and anybody I know. She and her family is special to me too. I don't think I ever mentioned this to you. I had a couple of rough years right before I came to the United States. I was depressed, pessimistic, and didn't trust people. It was Mom and Dad who showed me that the world is still full of love and helped me rebuild my belief in myself and people. I can't imagine where I would be now had I not crossed paths with Mom and Dad. I will miss Mom so much. So I'm very, very proud of my mother. Thank you.
And now it's time to sing, she said, but I didn't want to. We sang songs like, Kookaburra sits in the old gum tree. And we sang culturally relevant songs like, I didn't write that. Waltzing Matilda, you'll come a waltzing Matilda with me. And we even sang songs in other languages like, Viva la, viva la, viva la more, viva la, viva la, viva la more, viva la more, viva la more, viva la company. Because it was very important to her that we had a wide knowledge of music, and it was not very important to me. But she didn't ask for my opinion. And so my mom dropped my sisters and me off at her house and she would teach us to sing. And if she did notice that I wasn't totally enthusiastic about it, she sure didn't let on. When the whole family got together for holidays and birthdays, she would pass out song sheets and say, and now we're going to sing. And most people gamely participated, and some of them looked over the sheets and rolled their eyes a little bit and made comments like, wow, who knew there were 15 songs about Thanksgiving? And I looked to see if she noticed, and I don't think she did. But if she did, it didn't seem to bother her at all. She seemed to think that it was important enough that all of us gather together and sing those songs. The songs you learn when you're young become more than just songs. They always become part of your personality, who you are. And no matter how long you wait before you sing them again, the words come right back. And another thing about songs you learn when you're young is you always remember who taught them to you. And so, because of my grandma, I realized I always have a song to sing. So when the drill sergeant at Fort Benning said, "I'm bored tonight. If any one of you privates can sing me a song, I won't make you all do push-ups," I said, "I have a song to sing." And though there really was nothing special about the way I sang the Christmas song, there was something special about "O Holy Night" being sung on a humid July evening in Georgia at basic training. So now, when I walk into the classroom and tell the students, "Now we're going to sing," and they roll their eyes or make comments like, "How many hymns is this guy gonna make us learn?" I don't even notice. But if I do, it doesn't bother me at all. And I observed one thing about Grandma, and that was, though she loved music and the songs, it wasn't about the songs for song's sake, it was about the message. And the song was the vehicle to communicate that message. And I realized that when you know the truth of God and you're filled with His love, it's hard not to want to communicate that message to the people around you. So even though it took me probably longer than it should have to realize, I eventually did realize that when Grandma asks you to sing a song, you were going to sing a song. So 15 years ago, when she handed me a folder and said, "I want this music at my memorial," I knew that I would be here singing this song that she asked me to sing. What I didn't know is I would be able to have my family with me to sing it, and that's a great joy to us. All of us are up here today because we want to sing this song called "Sing a Cheery Song," the song that Grandma asked us to sing. Sing a cheery song all the day along. Christ's love is contagious. Brighten every mile with a happy smile. You will find His love to be advantageous. If the way is bright or as dark as night, trust and be courageous, and the rain of blessing will contain. If you trust His love all the way along. And this time in the service, we've reserved some time for stories. If you have a memory or a brief story to share, we have microphones and we'll bring them to you. Please stand where you are if you'd like to share it. Thank you.
I'd like to hear a thought, a memory, something you appreciate about Virginia, and we'll bring a mic to you and just say your name and how you're connected, and then we'll take a couple of sentences.
I'm Pastor Brian Cuff from Harvest Church International in Baltimore, Virginia, went a number of years to our church. And the greatest thing that I really learned about Virginia, and the word to me that describes her, is consistency. She was absolutely consistent every time you'd see her. Every time. It doesn't matter what's going on. Virginia is consistent and also very, very faithful. And you can see the fruit. Any tree is known by its fruit. Look at the fruit that has grown out of this family and what is happening. And it has to do with the matriarch and the patriarch. Bob, I love you, and we're praying for you. But just what Virginia is, when I say is, because she still is, just in another place, what a blessing she's been to our church and to the church family abroad in the cities.
Thank you very much. Okay, somebody else? Just a thought, a memory, something you appreciate.
My name is Martha Moultrie, and for years, Virginia and I went to Emerald Baptist Church together. Bob and Virginia came over. I would fix dinner, and Bob would help me to repair something that I wanted to have fixed at the house many times. The favorite memory I have of Virginia, though, is we had been paired. We put our names in if we wanted a prayer partner, and then we were just selected, and I ended up being Virginia's prayer partner. I'd go to her house, or she would come to my house, and we would pray together. And then she would always ask me, you know, if there was something special. And I was really upset at one point because I had a room that needed to be painted. And I moaned and groaned for several weeks about painting this house. And one day Virginia said, "Just do it." And I've used that over the years. Anytime I get to something that I don't want to do, I can hear Virginia saying, "Just do it." I get it.
My name is Timothy D. Cohen, and I know a lot of baseball players that would be quite envious or jealous of the fact that Virginia Pearson is batting 1,000 when it comes to cooking good meals. I was on the receiving end of some of those meals and actually had the Pearsons over to my house one time for dinner. And I agree with Pastor Brian Cuff, who's a quality friend and brother of mine, that it's not just a comfort, Bob and Bob Jr. and the rest of the family, that she still is. And she just will always be my sister. She still is a good woman. And my wife, Wendy Sue, and myself had come for some dinners to the house. And before they left to go to the home they were in, she was still asking if I wanted to come over for dinner. And I'm just blessed to get to be a part of their family. And again, I'm a good cook, but not a chef, but I don't know of many people that are about 1,000, but every meal she ever cooked was really quality.
In 1959, my wife Hola and I moved from the territory of Alaska to Eugene, Oregon, and eventually found our ways to Emerald Baptist Church. And within a few years, we met a couple, Bob and Virginia Pearson. And eventually, Virginia became my Sunday school teacher for the young married couples class there. And she mentored many of us young married people for quite a long time, most of her life. And at that time, while I was struggling quite a bit with some of my questions about Christianity and so on and so forth, and one that I struggled with was, what is sin? I just kind of struggled with that question. And one day I was talking with Virginia about it, and she said, "Coy," she says, "quit trying to make it so difficult." She says, "Why don't you use a simple recipe? If it comes between you and God, it is probably sin." I have used that all my life, those simple words from Virginia Pearson. And I would say that for Ola and I, Virginia Pearson is one of the foundational blocks in our life and our marriage. and I thank her very much.
Good afternoon. Thank you for being here. My name is Dan. I'm privileged to be part of the family, thanks to Mayor Leahy. But part of that was thanks to Virginia, too. I first met the family when Bob signed up for Neolife, and he saw me, and he thought I'd be a good prospect to do some distributorship work. But he couldn't sign me up, so he sent me to Grandpa. Well, that's when I fell in love with the first Pearson lady, Grandma Lucy Pearson. I just loved her. And then I met Virginia Pearson, and I fell in love with her as well. She thought I might be a prospect for Mayor Leahy. So, as mothers do, she invited me to dinner. Well, I smelled a rat there. I thought it was a setup, and it was. So guess what I did? I conveniently forgot to come to dinner. Uh-oh, Virginia was a little miffed at me. But she forgave me, and then she did bite me again. And I tell you, when I sat down to that meal, around that table, the table sat 14 people, believe it or not. And usually that table was full with people visiting. But her meatloaf was unlike any I'd ever had anywhere else. I haven't been able, Marilee can't make it like her mom. Sorry.
Don't say that, Dan. Don't say that, Dan.
But, and then she had this fried chicken recipe that was just incredible. Well, I came to love Virginia too, not just because of her cooking, but because of her hospitality, her love. Hospitality meant a lot to Virginia because I believe it was her mother's heart. See, her mother died when she was 4.5 years old, and she didn't really have a mother. She was raised by her grandmother. Virginia was complex. She was brilliant. Bob always said that she was way smarter than him, and Bob's a genius, by the way. She went on a road trip with me once, and she told the family afterwards, she said, "I like that Dan. He takes time to stop and smell the flowers along the way." And that was Virginia. She loved to do things. She liked to be with people. She liked to travel. And our hearts were one together that way. She loved flowers, and every Memorial Day, she would come to my yard and pick my American Beauty roses. And she'd take those to the grave sites scattered around Oregon. She'd go to at least 5 or 6 different graves and decorate them with American Beauty roses. Well, when she was failing, I got to spend time with her at the house, and she said to me, "Dan, I love you." And I said, "Mom, I love you too." We didn't need to say any more, because you felt that love. Her spirit was so filled with the Spirit of God. And it filled that room. You could feel the presence of God with Virginia, and we were impacted by that. Well, when she passed, I wrote a letter to Jackson and Perkins and told them they should name a flower after Virginia Dale Pearson, an American Beauty Rose.
My name is Mohammed Maliki. I came here as a student from Iran. I was a freshman at LCC. I was looking for a host family to learn about American culture and improve my English. One day I missed my bus on 19th and Patterson, that's where the old First Baptist Church was. So I had 15 minutes waiting for the next bus. I thought I'd go in and find out, see if I can find a host family. I went in and they introduced me. They said somebody at the church gave me Virginia's number. You've got to talk to Virginia. So I got the phone number and called a few days later. I talked to Virginia and she said, yeah, why don't you come out for dinner? I will meet. So that's typically that Virginia hospitality always invite you for dinner. So I went for dinner. We started talking. They liked me. But Virginia said, why don't you come and live with us? But my daughter is coming back from Texas in a week. So you can stay with us for a week and then we'll see what my release is. Making a long story short, I ended up living with them for 1 year. But what is so great about the entire Pearson family, particularly about Bob and Virginia, this is at the time that there was a revolution in Iran and there was hostility against Iranian students and even in America. But I felt loved and welcomed by Virginia and Bob. They just took me just as if I was one part of the family. And this was the time that my mother had passed away. So she filled the place of the mother. And truly, I love her with all my heart and I miss her. She's a wonderful soul. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing. We have one way back over on the left. Maybe one or so more out of this area.
This is, I met Marilee and Dan first, and we all went to Pastor Brian's church, Church of the Harvest, and I was going through a difficult time in my life with my husband, and our marriage was on the rocks, and I remember seeing the conference that was coming into town, and it was a weekend to remember my family life, and I said to myself, Lord, I really want to go there, you know, this is my heart's desire. Didn't have the money at the time, so we just kind of like, I didn't mention this to anyone. One afternoon, we get a knock at the door, and it's Bob. And he comes there, and I was like, his hugs, I can never, ever get enough of his hugs. I need them. And so he comes there, and he's standing there, and he just took my hands, and he handed me these two tickets. And I'm just looking at him, he says, me and my wife have been praying for you and your husband, and I really think that this is what you guys need to go. And I remember sitting there, like, God, you're so awesome. He had no idea that I had been praying this. And Bob and Virginia invited me and my family over for dinner and always welcomed to see it. And every time I went to church, the first thing, I needed a hug. My Sundays did not go right unless I get a hug from Bob. But I'm so grateful because I had the opportunity to be in Marilee's life and to be in her husband's life. And then she passes down to her mother and father. So thank you so much, Marilee, for sharing them with me and my family.
Hi, my name is Pam Martinez, and I was one of the people that got to live in the big house here in Eugene. And I came to the house after I was supposed to marry somebody and it had fallen apart. So I was kind of a messed up kid. And what I remember is the big table that was huge. And then all of a sudden, it seemed like I was living in a very international home. I think that the first time I ever saw rice served for breakfast was at Virginia's house because we had a bunch of kids from Vietnam that had come, and that's what they wanted to eat, and I thought that was pretty unique. But I remember her songs so well. I have some classics from her that I have kept that were songs that we sang. We always had devotions and sang around the table. Even though I didn't leave there in the best, I was still kind of messed up. I feel like, you know, it has reminded me that we are all steps in people's lives. There's a time where we can be that person kind of walking people through hard times. And even though it wasn't really maybe a success story for Bob and Virginia, for me, their faithfulness to take me in and allow me to be there and sort of grieve during that time really allowed me to become the person I am today. And so there's, you know, we all have that gift inside of us to do that for somebody. I just love the life of Virginia. She's really, she was really an inspiration for me as well.
Thank you. Don't want to let my sister upstage me. my name's Rusty Weaver. Hi, you guys. Sorry we didn't get here early enough to say hi. But our parents, myself and two of my sisters are here, we're just three representatives of seven of us. But our parents were colleagues, Uncle Bob and Aunt Virginia. Two of us here traveled with John and Mary Lee and Uncle Bob and Aunt Virginia across the Atlantic in 1953 when I was six, and I don't know, you were three, okay. And you were one, you weren't two yet, it was 53. Anyway, and of course, we grew up on the mission field in Congo, and there everybody was aunt and uncle. There was no Mr. and Mrs. this and that. And she was a dear person. And our one other sibling who went on that trip, who isn't here today because she's way down in Phoenix, Arizona, but she did want me to pass on hers and my main memory of Aunt Virginia, which was her singing. But particularly her singing, Dingbat, the singing cat, who loved to sing, but he'd sing flat. So I just wanted to pass that on.
Thanks. Hi, my name is Wu Yan. I grew up in China. I'm one of the international students well taken care of by Bob and Virginia. When I grew up, I learned from my textbook that in Western society, relationship is cold, and in capitalist society, it's all about people's relationship is all about money. And when I met Bob and Virginia, it's proved to be so wrong. They show me love and kindness. When I got off the airplane, in the United States, I had no idea where I'm going to stay, and I don't even know how to use a credit card. Actually, I don't even have a credit card. I can't even tell what's the difference between a credit card and debit card. I have two suitcases with me, but I don't know why I was thinking mostly were books. I didn't even have any bedding or anything. So Virginia picked me up from Portland and took me to her house and gave me whatever I need to stay. And so I stayed with them for a week or so, and then she found another place for me to stay, a place very close to University of Oregon, where I met my husband. He's from Japan. And Bob took me to the campus and taught me how to register, how to apply for a credit card, and take me to the bank. And they just modeled to me how Christians live and how to live like Jesus. I really thank them. I miss Virginia. Thank you.
Grandma Virginia taught me many things: how to play the piano, dance the Virginia reel, make eggplant parmesan, run a successful vacation Bible school, value a good education, and much more. As I learned more about her life, I realized she had endured many difficulties, and yet instead of becoming angry or bitter because of them, she chose to be thankful, joyful, and hospitable, making the world and others better for having known her. Grandma Virginia was a smart, talented, educated lady of skills, many skills and accomplishments, but the greatest of these is love. Many of her husband's ideas were wild and seemed impossible, and yet she never gave up on him, loving him for better or for worse until death parted them. She chose to encourage, respect, and support her visionary husband, to be faithful to him and work hard day after day behind the scenes to make his dreams a successful reality. My husband is also a visionary, and I am inspired to treat him with the same respect and support that Grandma Virginia demonstrated for 67 years of marriage. I will leave you with this poem, which she loved and made me recite until I had it memorized. Like my brother David, I did not see the value of memorizing or reciting poetry when she made me do it, but now I do. As our culture increasingly sees a long and happy marriage as something that cannot be done, as thousands prophesy failure when they hear the ambitious dreams and wild ideas of a visionary man, I remember Grandma Virginia's greatest lesson for me. She started to sing as she tackled this and many other things that couldn't be done, and she did them. Somebody said that it couldn't be done, but he with a chuckle replied that maybe it couldn't, but he would be one who wouldn't say so till he tried. So he buckled right in with the trace of a grin on his face. If he worried, he hid it. He started to sing as he tackled the thing that couldn't be done, and he did it. Somebody scoffed, "Oh, you'll never do that. At least no one ever has done it." But he took off his coat and he took off his hat, and the first thing we knew, he'd begun it. With a lift of his chin and a bit of a grin, without any doubting or quit it, he started to sing as he tackled the thing that couldn't be done, and he did it. There are thousands to tell you it cannot be done. There are thousands to prophesy failure. There are thousands to point out to you one by one the dangers that wait to assail you. But just buckle right in with a bit of a grin, without any doubting or quit it. Just start in to sing as you tackle the thing that cannot be done, and you'll do it.
Okay.
My name is Hui. I know Bob of Virginia many, many years ago through my sister. I was in the East Coast. My sister came to UO to be a student. She went to a Chinese New Year party. Before that party, she worked hard for many days to prepare for the party. That day, she went there hours earlier. However, her coat and her purse was removed from a table because another group of Chinese students, they want to be together. And my sister felt ignored, sad, alone. Bob noticed her. Bob asked her, "Honey, are you okay?" And started to talk to my sister. And from that day, Bob and Virginia brought love, care, and kindness to her lonely heart of my sister. They started to take care of her, to ask her what they can help. From that time on, my sister always told me, "Don't worry about me. I have Virginia and Bob." And when my sister got a